Hey guys, today I'm gonna put the 3000 series Ryzen 7 head to head against its bigger brother, the Ryzen 9, to see if this would rise up to the challenge in terms of gaming and content creation. Actually, more about content creation, because if you're a content creator like me, you probably haven't seen the inside of your favorite game in the past 10 years. You probably forgot all about the keybinds already. When you get inside the game, it's like riding a bicycle for the first time in 10 years. I know, you guys are gonna ask me,
Shane, why are you talking about the 3000 series when the 5000 series is coming out already? Oh, is MOBHouse dedicated to delivering old news?
No, because you know what they say? In with the new, out with the old. With the 5000 series coming soon, there's going to be a price drop for the 3000 series, or so I'm told. Who told?
I heard it through the grapevine. Not much longer would you be mine.
Disclaimer, this video is brought to you by AMD, but they told me I could say whatever I want. And I know a lot of you have to work from home right now because of the Verona crisis, and you can't wait for the 5000 series to drop. So I'm gonna cover these guys if you need to work from home and are a creative professional like Lim Beck. Okay, we can all joke about the price drop, but if you've ever bought a processor before, you would know that there's quite a huge jump between the Ryzen 7 to the Ryzen 9. Today, we're going to be comparing three different processors: the Ryzen 7 3700X, the Ryzen 7 3800XT, and the Ryzen 9 3900XT. The Ryzen 7 3700X is 1499, the Ryzen 7 3800XT is 1899, and the Ryzen 9 3900XT is 2299. I chose these processors because there's exactly 400 ringgit difference between each tier. While the processor is definitely very important while building a PC for work and gaming, it is not the only component you need to pay attention to when you're doing content creating tasks such as 2D and 3D design, video editing, color grading, audio mixing, and even transcoding, compositing, and streaming. You also need to pay attention to parts such as the GPU if you do any GPU accelerated workloads, your motherboard to make sure that your chipset has all the features that you need such as PCIe 4 and all that good stuff, connectivity options such as USB, Thunderbolt, network options such as Wi-Fi and good internet speeds, as well as PCIe modules such as a capture card if you do streaming. If you do any color crucial work, your monitor will also cost you quite a bit as well. You also need to look at your PSU to make sure you have a very reliable power supply unit. And finally, even your CPU cooler and casing will matter, because having good airflow and temperature will ensure that you have ample overclocking headroom as well as good turbo boost performance if you should leave the settings to auto with these processors, which I think 99% of you guys should do anyways. Let's face it, amidst the current unfortunate event called the Verona crisis, nobody's doing well. So if you can save a few bucks, why not? Let's see if the Ryzen 7 is good enough for you, or do you need to upgrade to the Ryzen 9? Let's get cracking. Before we start, to those of you guys who are unfamiliar, the XT processors as compared to the X processors are actually a variant with better silicone quality. Much like your new wife's silicone cup coasters. What are you thinking? Oi, jangan terpesong! Anyways, the XT processors will essentially give you better overclocking headroom and boost performance at lower voltages. And this is very important because there has been a lot of reports regarding 3000 series processors degrading when overclocked with voltage values above 1.35 volts. Besides that, being able to set lower voltages for your processors ensure that they will run cooler, and this means that your fans can spin slower to ensure that you have a quiet and obedient workstation so you can focus and play Minesweeper. So you can play with your new wife's silicone cup coasters. I already told you just now already. This is a PG-13 website, bro. You think what? Hiya! So now let's take a closer look at the specifications of these three processors. So the Ryzen 7 3700X has 8 cores and 16 threads, a base clock of 3.6 GHz and a max turbo boost clock of 4.4 GHz. The Ryzen 7 3800XT has the same amount of cores and threads, but a faster base and boost clock. Actually, we should technically be comparing the 3800 XT to the 3800X, but because of the price difference, like I mentioned before, like 400 bucks difference between all three processors, I chose the 3700X instead. Finally, the Ryzen 9 3900 XT has 12 cores and 24 threads. It has a base clock of 3.8 GHz, which is the same as the 3900X, but a max turbo boost clock that is slightly higher, 100 MHz higher actually, at 4.7 GHz. Other than the core count and clock speeds, another factor you should look at when picking a processor for workstation purposes is cache. Now, I'm not talking about the cache in your wallet, I'm talking about this cache. Now, since you guys are here, you probably already know what a RAM is. It is a type of physical memory. The cache is another type of physical memory, albeit it's a lot ultra fast because it acts as a middleman between your CPU and your RAM, and it is integrated into your CPU itself. It operates a lot faster when it comes to data that you use regularly and repeatedly, making your computing experience a lot snappier. Cache, while not being that important for things such as gaming, is extremely important when it comes to productivity tasks such as 3D design, where it can give you faster preview as well as shorter render times. For instance, the Ryzen 9 3900 XT has 1.5 times more L1 and L2 cache and 2 times more L3 cache than the Ryzen 7 3800 XT. As a comparison, this is what the blue team has to offer. We are looking at the Intel i9-10900K as well as the i7-10700K. Leave a comment down below if you want to find out more about the cache so that we can explain it to you.
Technically.
Is that how Michelle sound like? Before we move on to benchmarks, let's take a look at our test bench, which I feel is a perfect balance between performance and value when it comes to setting up a PC for either of these processors. For the motherboard, we are rocking the ASRock X570 Tai Chi motherboard, which remains one of my top picks for X570 motherboards today. Why am I not going for the B550 motherboard instead? Well, because the X570 simply has more connectivity options and, most importantly, PCIe lanes, which is very important when it comes to building a workstation PC. A 3rd Gen Ryzen 3000 CPU gives you exactly 24 PCIe 4.0 lanes on the CPU, and with a X570 motherboard, you can use all 24 lanes, 16 for GPU, 4 for storage, and 4 for the chipset link. While only 20 can be used with the B550 motherboard, with 16 for GPU and 4 for storage. Firstly, for creative work, we often do things that will saturate the PCIe lanes, such as setting up NVLink or SLI, if you are rich like me and have 2 3090 to spare. Secondly, X570 supports 2 M.2 slots with full-on PCIe Gen 4 speeds as opposed to the one in the B550 motherboard. And we all know how important storage speeds are for creative work. Finally, for a workstation PC, you should also look at 5G and 10G LAN, which the X570 supports, while the B550 only supports gigabit or 2.5 gigabit LAN. For gaming, the B550 is just fine, but if you're transferring files between multiple workstations and your NAS or server, having 5G and 10G LAN is very important when transferring files. Also, the X570 supports more SATA and usually more USB ports, which is very important if you use a lot of things such as color panels, the loop deck, as well as official software that still uses dongles today. Why? You tell me lah! After the motherboard, you should also look at the power supply, and in this case, we are using the Corsair RM850 80 plus gold power supply. This should be adequate if you're pairing all three of these processors with something such as the RTX 3080. We are going for an RTX 3090 and above, or some of the newer big Navi cards that are coming soon, you should probably look at a 1000 watts power supply and above, because those bigger graphics cards are a sucker for power. When it comes to cooling, there's no such thing as overkill, and we're using the Thermaltake Water 3.0 360 ARGB Sync TT Premium Edition AIO cooler. Alternately, you could go for a high quality 240 or 280 AIO if your case doesn't support a massive 360mm radiator. The final two things that you should pay attention to is RAM and storage. For RAM, we went with 32GB of 3200MHz Geel Superloose AMD Edition. If you're doing any sort of heavier work such as 3D, 4K editing, sharding, compositing, and all that good stuff, you should consider going up to 64GB of RAM or even 128GB of RAM, because there's no such thing as an overkill. For storage, we went with 2TB of PCIe 4.0 Aorus SSD. So for our benchmarks, we're comparing all three processors at their auto turbo boost clock compared to their fixed static 4.2GHz overclock. While setting all these processors to an all-core 4.2GHz static overclock, we were able to get the Ryzen 7700X to run at 1.3 volts, the Ryzen 7800XT at 1.25 volts, and the Ryzen 9900XT at 1.35 volts. Firstly, in synthetic benchmarks, we have Cinebench R20, and in multi-core, Ryzen 9900XT is roughly 45% faster than both the 3700X and 3800XT at turbo settings, and about 50% faster in fixed 4.2GHz overclocked. In single core, as you can see, the performance is pretty much the same. Next, we tested TimeSpy and TimeSpy Extreme, and we're gonna just look at the CPU numbers. Looking at TimeSpy, the Ryzen 9900XT is roughly 20 to 25% faster than both Ryzen 7 processors. In TimeSpy Extreme, the Ryzen 9 processor is about 45 to 50% faster than both the Ryzen 7 processors. Moving on to gaming benchmarks, I think that it wouldn't make much of a difference, but here we go. In both Shadow of the Tomb Raider and Death Stranding in 1440p as well as 4K, all processors performed pretty much the same as predicted. Moving on to real-world productivity tests, the first one is Blender. Since Blender does take advantage of the multi-core processors, this is evident with the Ryzen 3900XT taking quite a lead. Both Ryzen processors are actually neck and neck, but pay in mind that the 3800XT uses quite a lot less voltage to achieve these numbers. The same story can be said in the BMW Blender test as well. Looking at V-Ray CPU benchmarks, the Ryzen 9900XT is actually in its own league, with both Ryzen 7 processors performing pretty much the same given our test parameters. Next, we look at Premiere Pro, and since Premiere Pro is still pretty much single core oriented, clock speeds is what matters in most cases. As you can see, having cores after a certain number does not make much of a difference, so Premiere Pro editors do pay that in mind. Again, in After Effects, things didn't make much of a difference, but one could argue that that's probably because of our test methodology. We could probably test it with different files or maybe something a little bit heavier in order to push these processors to their potential. But in a software as optimized as DaVinci Resolve Studio 16, as you can see, having more cores does pay off. For some reason, auto seems to be doing wonders for the Ryzen 9. See? What did I say? Finally, we tested the processors with the Ada 64 stress test for more than 15 minutes in an ambient temperature of 25 Celsius with an open bench. And here are the numbers. So those are the numbers which us Asians like, and what is the conclusion? If you're a 3D animator that works with software such as 3ds Max, Blender, V-Ray, Maya, and all the good stuff, as well as video editors or color graders that work with DaVinci Resolve Studio or Free, you should just go with the Ryzen 9 because it is the clear winner, because the raw performance translates when the software is optimized well enough. For everybody else, especially you Adobe Premiere Pro fanboys out there, just stick with the Ryzen 7 because in that world, it cannot utilize all the beautiful cores inside the Ryzen 9 as of now yet, and single core performance is still king in that world, with the Ryzen 7 3800XT being slightly better, so either of these processors will serve you well. Okay, we did also do some tests with gaming with these processors, but realized that the numbers are actually pretty unimpressive, so we thought that it would be pointless to include those. If you are gaming, just go for a Ryzen 3 or Ryzen 5 processor, and if you are working and gaming, you can pick either of these and it will be fine, but I would personally pick the Ryzen 9. Because I'm using potentially an RTX 3090 or a very, very big Navi. I don't want to bottleneck my graphics card. And in most gaming scenarios, the graphics card is actually a lot more important than processors these days, especially with AMD processors. So that's that. Stay tuned if you want to see us test the new 5000 series processors in gaming, because we'll definitely do that. They are new processors after all. We want to see if anything has improved in the gaming department when it comes to AMD. If you thought this video is awesome, don't forget to like and share. Leave a comment down below if you have any questions regarding these processors, or if you think that you have a better idea of how to use these processors, let us know. Or if you want to see more benchmarks comparing these processors with the new 5000 series processors, so leave a comment down below. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell to see more content like this. Follow us on Instagram and Facebook to see more shenanigans. My name's Shane Nanigans. And I will see you in the next one.
Bye.
Stay safe, stay home, game on.